So thank you. I'm really thrilled, just totally thrilled to be here. I got my doctorate in psychology, let's see, right up the road at Catholic University in human development. And I'm from DC originally, and now I'm based out of Portland, Maine. So I want to talk to you for the next, not at you for the next hour, I want to have a conversation for the next hour or so that hopefully will answer some questions that I just heard come up in my own group and in the report out about how do we do this, you know, how do we get these sound bites and elevator speeches, and what do we have to think about? I'm not going to go through my background since Lauren just did, but the trajectory was, you know, out of the academy after tenure, I guess they're still sort of talking about me where I was, that nobody else had left at that point, to do more social change kind of work. And I was vice president at the Frameworks Institute here in Washington, which does a lot of research into people's understanding of social problems and testing frame effects, and then wanted to really spend more time one-on-one time with experts and policy advocates and scientists, helping you all figure out how to talk about your issues. So when I was putting this presentation together, I was finding myself kind of challenged, and my husband said, well, why are you challenged? I said, well, I'm a psychologist who's going to be telling a room full of psychologists how to use psychology to talk about psychology to non-psychologists. I mean, it's like so meta, I'm not really quite sure what to do. And I'm kind of worried that you all know this already. So I think what I've done is I'm packaging some things that are going to be familiar to you in a way that you can think about, oh, that's right, I do know this. I just didn't realize, you know, this could be used as a hammer, or, you know, it wasn't in the toolbox. So through my entire career trajectory, you know, what did I learn? Well, something about social cognition. I love this quote. There's a great deal of received wisdom, a great deal of things that people have known for generations, and most of the time the things people know are the enemies of what they learn. What great philosopher said that? Bill James, who's a baseball statistician. If you're familiar with Nate Silver, you might, or have seen the movie Moneyball. His theories are kind of behind that. I also, so essentially, you know, our minds are ready to wreak havoc on well-intentioned communications about social problems. I also learned something about stories and social change, and so I've been really attentive to people's talking about wanting to use anecdotes and how do we tell these stories. And something I want to share with you is that standard stories are those in which all that happens is the result of characters' actions. But that doesn't align well with social life, where causes are incremental, indirect, interactive, unintended, collective, and environmentally mediated. So I'm going to talk a little bit more specifically later, but there's a challenge with standard storytelling techniques when it comes to improving public understanding of social issues. So many advocates had come to me saying, well, we want to do a big splashy communications campaign and to have the same impact that, say, something like Designated Driver had. And Designated Driver was always held up to me as, like, you know, the kind of the prototype of a successful campaign. And I was a little curious about that, so I decided I was going to start looking into this. After years of hearing this and kind of doubting it, I thought, hey, I'll check out the evidence. I actually know how to do that, right? And since 1983, there's been $1.3 billion in donated media. We should all be so lucky for our campaigns, right? Endorsements and promotion from several presidents, you know, NHTSA, MAD, the NBA, insurance companies, even brewers. You can go to pubs nowadays, right, and have Budweiser telling you to designate a driver. And there are some polling survey research that was done that showed that 84% of people surveyed recalled or hearing or seeing a public service announcement. That is enormous recall, specific recall. 80% stopped a friend from driving drunk, and interestingly, only 25% stopped themselves from driving drunk. So I guess we're really all altruists at heart. So you look at this data, and you know, arguably it's effective, right? But what percent of all traffic fatalities today do you think are caused by alcohol-impaired drivers? What percent? 50%? I should just show you the graph instead. It's 31%, which is still a lot, right? And of those involved in traffic fatalities, those drivers were 8 times more likely to have a prior OUI or DWI. And today, there's one alcohol-impaired fatality every 52 minutes. So I started thinking, well, what did designated driver do? It raised awareness, but to what effect? I mean, it seems like it's not keeping the people who are the greatest offenders off the road. So maybe all of us kind of got a clue, but certain people didn't. But there's also, you know, program evaluation research and a study in 2005 that did a program evaluation of all designated driver programs found they were not effective at reducing alcohol-impaired driving. And the things that were, or that are, ignition interlocks, roadside sobriety, enforcing the minimum legal drinking age, enforcement of zero tolerance laws, those are the things that have been shown to be effective at actually reducing alcohol-impaired driving. So at the same time I'm hearing from advocates that this is the campaign they want to do, public health advocates were saying in some states it was harder to pass this kind of legislation because the issue had been framed as about individual responsibility. So it was hard for policymakers to see the structural, systemic, public dimensions of the issue because we all just had, oh, well, it's just our personal responsibility to designate a driver. And now there's a big buzz driving campaign because so many thought the messages to be targeted at overtly drunk drivers and not them. When decision time came, some of us would get, you know, buzzed, would be buzzed and get behind the wheel. So now there's another campaign to try to make buzz driving drunk driving. And that campaign really is the rule, not the exception. Looking across ads that, you know, I'll throw a couple up here. This one on obesity, portions have grown, so has obesity, which can lead to many health problems. Cut your portions, cut your risk. What's the problem? You're eating too much. Who's responsible? You are. You have to cut your portions. Why? No talk here about, oh, how did portions get so ridiculously large, right? I did some work in children's oral health. This was a typical campaign. It's not easy being a parent, but here's something simple you can do, you know, so trying to get kids to brush and floss. And research has found the more you prime brushing and flossing, the harder it is for people to see why, I don't know, dental screenings in schools might be a better approach. You all know this one, just say no to drugs, right? Domestic violence, abuse, I work with a lot of folks in child abuse and neglect prevention work, and this tends to be what we do. So this is an old campaign you may recall from domestic violence. It says, talking with a friend who's being beaten up by her husband will never be easy. We understand you want to say just the right thing in just the right way. If you need help finding the words, 1-800-END-ABUSE. And global warming. If you don't recycle, Susie, the earth will heat up, the oceans will explode, and boiling rain will scald all the baby animals. Any questions? So this is, I think, just kind of the perfect example. So I'm not suggesting that this stuff isn't ever appropriate if you're targeting behavior change, but it tends to be what we do for all issues that are far more complex. These strategies obscure the public and structural dimensions of social problems and fail often to improve understanding of the causes, consequences, and solutions, and build support for public policy and program solutions. So if you want to do that, then I can help you, right? That's where I focus my time, because I think we can't use these kinds of strategies and hope to get this kind of thing understood. And why do we do it? Well, a lot of this, you know, what we think about communications comes from product marketing, where we're trying to, as a colleague of mine used to say, it's a point of purchase decision. I want you to buy this cat food. I want you to elect that mayor or governor. And, you know, thinking about the research that we read, the influence of social psychology research on persuasion certainly has probably played a role, right? But that's with specific behavior. A lot of these kinds of techniques are used with smoking, drinking, breastfeeding, substance use, health services utilization. And so that's appropriate. But if we're talking about social change, we are talking about public policy. for which there are national, regional, state, local, and individual solutions. So we have to have communications that aren't just about individual solutions. Does that make sense? So basically what I learned in all of this is we have to reconsider our traditional communication approaches to social problems. Most people approach communications for issues with the tools on the left. Oh, I'm going to think of a really great slogan or logo or brand or headline or press release, and we're going to hire a graphic designer to make it look good, and then we'll see, you know, how much news coverage we got, right? Quantity measures. And I'm kind of out there helping experts and policy folks and advocates say, well, let me tell you a little bit about how we think and process information, and then let me share with you some evidence from communications science and framing research about what we should be doing, and then you can do the art part, okay? That's when that comes in, but only after that. So here's where I tell you what you already know, how people reason about their social worlds. But I want you to think about what this means for how you would communicate about your issues, right? Our thinking is guided by schema. Is there anybody in the room who disagrees with with that, right? So, but this is news to a lot of people that I talk to. So preconceived ideas, assumptions, beliefs are helping us organize information. So if I show you this, what are these? Horses. What are these? Dogs. Puppies, dogs. What is this? Okay, that is, see, you don't know, right? That is Lorenzo Il Magnifico, my Great Dane. And he, children often come to our gate and say, horsey, 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 because he doesn't fit their schema for dog until they interact with him. Oh, he's on a leash. Oh, he's got a squeaky toy. And oh, he's popping out of the boat hatch. And he's being a lap dog if you want to play Sudoku or whatever. Anyway, I sort of can't help myself with that. But what does this have to do with how people think about issues? How we frame influences which schema people are going to rely on for interpretation. And you know that once a schema is doing its work to help us interpret something, it's hard to dislodge, right? And you also know that it's not just about personal schema. We have cultural schema. We have culturally mediated patterns of reasoning, which, you know, clearly Dr. Hart this morning and Dr. Devine were talking about how they had to overcome and knock through and disrupt. If I ask you what you think about government, what comes to mind? Corruption, what's coming out of your paycheck? Bureaucracy. So even if you don't believe these things, if really in your heart you're saying, oh, infrastructure, common good, you know, publicness, you can still come up with the tropes that are out there in the culture, right? So across all of the research I've read and been involved in, I've boiled it down to sort of three cultural narratives that I think are out there ready to just eat your framing or hijack your frames about social problems. And here they are. America's the land of opportunity and individual responsibility is all that's needed to succeed. It's kind of the core American story, right? And there are elements of truth to that, but it totally obscures the public dimensions, right? There are inequalities because of choices, habits, and lifestyles, not because of historic oppression, structural racism, things like that. I was thinking yesterday, actually, when Dr. Smedley was presenting, and he talked about fairness as a value to get through to people. For certain folks, those who are of a more conservative ideology, things like income inequality, that doesn't disrupt their notion of fairness, because they think it's fair if certain people have more, but they'll explain it away as saying they worked harder. So you have to be even careful doing that kind of framing. And then that government is a problem, not a problem solver. There are ways around this, which I'll share with you momentarily, but I think if you, in thinking about talking about your work and the work that you do, if you consciously try to not step into these traps or invigorate these cultural narratives, we're all going to be better off. That would be a great place to start. The news media reinforce certain narratives at the expense of others, right? I mean, we've talked a little bit over the last couple days about vaccines, and one of the things with the media culture is that it's an argument culture, and so they will present two sides of a debate, even if it's one person over here. It happened in a community in my state where there was just one kind of reactionary anti-fluoride person, and then the entirety of the public health community on this side. But they were given, you know, and literally at a public presentation. So there were like 20 people here and one person here, and they got equal time on the news, right? Which makes you think that there are actually two equal sides. So there's that problem. There's also another problem. I'm not sure you know this, but most people aren't thinking about social problems most of the time. They're thinking about, I was thinking about the Patriots last night. I don't know about you, but they're thinking about what's going on at work. Are the kids on the bus? Am I supposed to pick them up? You know, what's for dinner? What's the weather, right? But you're a psychologist. You know it's even more complicated than that. It's not just cultural schema, news media, and a lack of attention. We are cognitive misers, as Fisk and Taylor told us many years ago. We use these schemas and heuristics as a rule. I love this. Every year, sharks kill 10 people. Every year, 100 people die from being stepped on by cows. Fear the real killer. did you read my paper on confirmation bias? Yes, but it only proved what I already knew. So, you know that this is how we think. Well, this is how people are going to be interacting with your research, particularly if it's not clearly explained, right? I show people all the time the classic Kahneman and Tversky conjunction base rate fallacy problem. So told Linda's 31 years old, single, outspoken, very bright. She majored in philosophy. As a student, she was deeply concerned with issues of discrimination and social justice. She participated in anti-nuclear demonstrations. Which is more probable, Linda's a bank teller, or Linda's a bank teller and is active in the feminist movement? If you haven't seen this, please don't respond, because you don't want to embarrass yourself. Because 85% of people generally pick B, right? And the reason that's wrong is because the probability of two events occurring together is always less than or equal to the probability of either one occurring alone. When presented with an unstoried version of that question, you're driving to work, which is more probable? You see a blue car, you see a blue Corvette. People making the same mistake? No. So that shows the power of storytelling. But sometimes it's just that power of storytelling that makes it bad for public policy. I've seen bad legislation passed because of the power of a personal story, and I think legislators will tell you, yeah, we've passed as much good as bad legislation because we've been so compelled by something. So there's an alternative to that, but I'm going to make you wait for it. Second, we're motivated reasoners. Like the they saw a game experiment that Dan Kahan talked about in the paper that we read, where Princeton and Dartmouth students somehow just were not able to correctly interpret or in an unbiased fashion the calls that happened in that very controversial game in the 50s. We engage in what he calls identity protective cognition. I kind of like that term. So our group allegiances, right, are the things that are like our schema, and they're likely to organize our thinking. You might also be thinking about dual processing theory, right? System one and system two, which actually Kahneman didn't invent, right? System one and system two, it came a little bit earlier, but we're all talking about it in this way now, and he talked about it in terms of fast and slow thinking. So system one being unconscious, intuitive, associative thinking, system two being slow, conscious, effortful, and deliberative. What I find interesting about this regarding science communication is that dual processing has led some people to posit that when you see polarization on issues in the public, it's because they're relying on system one. Okay, that any instance of ideological polarization is evidence of a system two deficit or system two not having been engaged yet. So that has led some to propose that if we have more cogent explications of science or bolster people's science comprehension, then ideological polarization will diminish because they'll start reasoning more objectively and system one won't have so much control over their judgments. System two is going to monitor and correct the unconscious knee-jerk reactions. Is that what happens? That is not what happens, no. I always thought that the very idea that conscious thought, system two monitors and corrects system one was kind of incoherent psychologically anyway. But there's great research on this by Dan Kahan. If I know you read a paper or at least got a paper, but I'd encourage you to delve into this a little bit as you're thinking about how to translate your own knowledge. So he sought out this question, you know, tried to answer this question, or has answered the question, I think, is science communication just about improving science comprehension? So I'm going to walk you through just, in one version of this talk, I had like three of his studies all summarized. I was like, oh, they don't need that. They don't need that much. They already know this. But here's one that's really compelling. So this is a nationally representative a sample of about 1,500 Americans who participated in a study via an online testing platform called Knowledge Networks, which some of you actually might use. So if deficit in science comprehension is to blame, then one would predict as science literacy and numeracy go up, people would perceive greater risk of climate change to human health, right? So the science comprehension deficit theory would predict this. Does that make sense? So lesser risk, greater risk on the y-axis, looking at literacy and numeracy. So he then combined science, and the science literacy stuff was the NSF. Somebody was mentioning it earlier. I think it might have been Dr. Devine. So just the science and engineering indicators, electrons are smaller than atoms, true or false, you know, this kind of thing. But then he combined literacy and numeracy questions into a composite scale of science literacy and numeracy, just to do away with any collinearity, I imagine. So this is what he found. How much risk do you believe climate change poses to human health, safety, or prosperity? That prediction, right, which we've already looked at, the actual variance is there in the middle. So there's almost no variance in perceived risk based on science literacy and numeracy. A little bit surprising, right? So what happens if you just look at cultural cognition? What if you throw culture into the mix? So Kahan studied the difference between hierarchical individualist and egalitarian communitarians regarding this perception of climate risk by numeracy. So some of you might be familiar with this grid of the originally from Mary Douglas, but just let me explain it to you if you're not familiar. If you look at the group dimension, so a low group worldview coheres with really individualistic social orders, right? You're expected to secure your own needs without collective assistance. A high group worldview, the communitarian, supports collective needs, trump individual initiative. Society is supposed to secure the conditions under which we can all thrive, that kind of thing. A high grid worldview favors a hierarchical society, and that is, you know, resources, rights, et cetera, are kind of distributed on the basis of fixed social characteristics regarding gender, race, class, lineage, et cetera. And a low grid worldview favors egalitarian society, so denying that social characteristics should matter in how we distribute resources. So hierarchical individualists were in the top half of the H and the I dimension, and egalitarian communitarians were in the top half of the E and C dimension. So based just on that, how would you predict they believe climate change, how much climate change risk poses to human health safety? This is the prediction. right? I mean, if you're a little bit suspicious that regulation is going to come and disrupt the free market, which you believe is you know the thing that's moving society, you're probably not going to perceive a lot of risk to climate change. If you're an egalitarian communitarian, on the other hand, you're probably going to believe that there's more risk. By the way, this does not mean Republican and Democrat or conservative and liberal. We might think that, but these are not conservatives versus liberals. The mean hierarchical individualist was an independent who leaned Republican, was slightly conservative, and the mean egalitarian communitarian was an independent who leaned left a little bit, okay? So here's what he found. The actual interaction of culture and science literacy numeracy is that polarization increases. So people are using, okay, so if you think of system one as the sort of big cultural category, right? People are using system two. They're calling it into service for their worldviews. So that, and this is a statistically significant effect. I know it doesn't look too much like that in this chart. So polarization increases as numeracy increases. Therefore, science comprehension is not the problem, right? It's not the only problem. So what do we know then? We know mental shortcuts, heuristics, biases characterize our thinking. Cultural narratives are very accessible, particularly for those repeated in discourse. And for culturally or politically charged issues, we're going to engage in this identity protective cognition. I'm the harbinger of good news here, aren't I? Yeah, this is, you're really thrilled that I'm speaking to you today. So this, I know this can make issue framing feel like you're navigating a maze, but as I often tell people, the structure of that maze can be known. So once you know, oh, if I do this, that's going to cue up, you know, the individual responsibility frame. I'm going to go over here, you know. So there are tools based on research, multi-method, empirical, from multi-sources done nationally that can help you get through the maze of public thinking about these issues. And that's the track that I'm leading tomorrow is we're going to delve into really how to do this. I'm going to give you a few tools here today, but I want to show you what happens when you don't consider the maze. So as I said, I live in Maine, and I don't know if any of you have the privilege of ever hearing about our governor, but he's very anti-welfare. And there was an article written in one of the papers about after a finding that nursing homes there was more committed more welfare fraud than welfare recipients. And this was the headline: welfare fraud by providers is bigger problem than individual welfare cheats. And all of my progressive friends are, you know, this is all over Facebook. They're thrilled that this article is out there. I'm like, no, take it down. Quit sharing this thing, you know. And so I threw it into a word cloud generator just for kicks. So where the bigger words are the ones that occur most often. And so this is the message, right? It's fraud. It's welfare. It's state. And I think one of the second lines in the article was that, you know, this isn't the kind of fraud that eats up taxpayer dollars is really this kind of fraud, not a food stamp recipient buying lobster. So all of the stereotyped images about welfare recipients were queued up in this article as in an attempt to refute them. Let me show you another example. I work with a health equity partnership in New Hampshire, and one of the things they had asked me to review was this infographic that they had on health equity. It really draws you in with the light, bright colors at first, doesn't it? I mean, so I told them, please don't put this out there, and I'll tell you why. There's some really good things going on. We can work together to solve it. You can help close the gap, that kind of thing. But I want to zoom in on the data. So in the green box, the first thing, this is New Hampshire, okay, which is 98% white. And the first data are minority women in New Hampshire 3 times more likely to have cardiovascular disease compared with white women. Minority men in New Hampshire almost twice as likely as white men to have diabetes. So what are the mostly white people in New Hampshire going to think about the causes and solutions to that problem? Where does it reside? Not, it's not my problem, right? So they're trying to, they're using this disparities data, which is a really difficult way to start a conversation based, and we know that from this morning, and trying to, you know, I mean, here's the thing. These are advocates. These are people who see systems and structures behind these numbers. And so they just kind of forgot that most people weren't going to see that. And they don't want to suppress racial disparity data in health outcomes, because then they're not telling the real story. So I said, okay, well, we're going to find another way to tell that story, one that includes cultural competence of healthcare providers and access issues and all of that, but not in the infographic, right? Because it's just a quick thing. So we revised this infographic, and I'm going to wait. I'm going to make you wait to see what it was again. So let's talk about this, the science of communication. There are lots of studies from different disciplines on science communication, on frame effects. You might have read some of these books. We were talking about Heath and Heath, Made to Stick, earlier in our session, but Shantara Yangar's research, the political scientists, of course, George Lakoff, Jonathan Haidt from social psychology, and Dan Kahneman and social movements theory, and all kinds of things, right? And I'm drawing, so I put this all up here because isn't it better than just like a bibliographic list? But I'm drawing from all of these things in the kind of applied work that I do with folks on framing. I really like Matt Nisbet's definition of what a frame is, though. It's an interpretive storyline that sets a specific train of thought in motion, communicating why an issue might be a problem, who or what might be responsible for it, and what should be done about it. So it's not spin, okay? Framing is not spin. Framing is good translation. So I don't want you to feel like what you have to learn how to do is spin your stuff. You know, it's not, it really is about translation. And the order of these things matters immensely. My experience is that most experts just talk about the problem and sometimes don't even link a solution to the problem. You sometimes do that with an overload of data. I don't know if you've noticed this about yourselves, but that tends not to be a good framing strategy. So I boil it down into these four questions. Why does the issue matter? What's the problem or challenge? How is it solved, and who can solve it? And Cheryl essentially said this same thing this morning in a slightly different way. I think she had three. But why does this matter, which is a values piece? What's the problem, how do you solve it, and who can solve it, which is a causal story about the work that you're doing. So effective issue frames really answer those things in particular ways, right? So appealing to values that structure meaning, and then connecting the dots among the causes, the consequences, and the solution. And I heard some of you say, oh, we're going to actually have to talk about solutions, which can just be research implications. That's okay. But it can be hard for some academics to put their stake in the ground about what then to do about it. But I would encourage you to at least think about that. Tomorrow, a colleague of mine, Michael Erard, will also be leading a session on metaphor development. So identifying some of your difficult constructs and having us play around with metaphors on that. So do people know what I'm talking about when I say values? Some yes, some no. So as Dr. Devine mentioned Milton Rokic, who says that a value is a general claim about desirable social and personal conditions like equality, freedom, interdependence. And values are stable, they're long-term goals, they orient our attitudes and behavior, right? They orient our political predispositions. And most scholars agree that maybe gradual change over the lifespan occurs, but they're established pretty early and they shape our major social and political beliefs and behaviors. So how can anchoring our frames in values help? I love this quote, values are powerful and efficient in shaping audience reasoning processes because they're heuristics, they're schema, right? So if you're starting at what the problem is or starting with data, you're allowing your audience to map on what this is about, and they might decide it's about individual responsibility. They might believe it's about a certain group who's been marginalized, their choices, lifestyle, et cetera. When Dr. Smedley was speaking the other night and he was saying, you know, we have to show the systems and structures, but you can't just say the public dimensions, the programs, you have to show people what it is that you're talking about. So, when Dr. Hart put that slide up there and showed, this is the law, this is cocaine, this is powder cocaine, this is crack cocaine, and here is the difference. There you have it, right? That's a brilliant frame for an issue. So the question you might have is, well, are there values that align with all dimensions, or do we have to target for every individual person we're talking with? And given what Kahan found, obviously there are different worldviews that you're up against. But for most issues that aren't politically charged, like climate change and maybe gun violence and other things, obviously, there's a lot more leeway. Okay, and most people don't have daily interaction with the issues on the public agenda. They hear about poverty, they hear about welfare, they hear about race, not from their personal interactions, but from the mediated discourse. So it gets pretty easy to predict what people are going to be thinking about an issue across education levels, across party ID, across gender. So I thought this might be a helpful way to talk about the values that align with all dimensions. So, as I said, I used to be at Frameworks Institute. There are other firms that do this. Even Dr. Smedley, was a co-founder of the Opportunity Agenda, which is doing a lot of this work. Drew Weston is out there doing a lot of this research, Lake Research Partners, et cetera. And I think these are the values that align across dimensions and that I've seen in my applied work help lift open conversations and get people to think collectively. So future prosperity, ingenuity, American ingenuity, we can do this, we can solve this. That is a core American narrative, but we're not tapping into it enough. Equal opportunity. But I think you can't just go around saying equal opportunity, because a lot of people, particularly white people, believe that equal opportunity is what you get with kindergarten and public education, and that's the level playing field. So you have to show disruptions to equal opportunity when there's been a procedural lack of fairness and opportunity to really get people to understand when that's been violated. Responsibly managing systems that we're in charge of is another thing most people can get behind. Stewardship, and not just for environmental issues, but for children. You know, as adults, we're responsible for providing the next generation with what they need to be healthy and well, et cetera. I also think that Jonathan Haidt's work, how many people are familiar with Jonathan Haidt's work? So many of you, but I think this is instructive, and I'm just going to put up one slide. He's essentially said that he thinks that the moral mind is like a tongue with six taste receptors, and that are the really foundations of our ethics, and that our culture constructs narratives and institutions really on top of these foundations. So you have care versus harm, fairness versus cheating, liberty versus oppression, loyalty versus betrayal, authority versus subversion, and then sanctity versus degradation. And he's looked at how this pans out according to different ideologies. And so I like this chart. I think this chart says a lot. So this is just where liberals and conservatives, how they differ on these six moral foundations in terms of their endorsement of these things. And the reason I think this is really instructive to people who are interested in social change and who might generally, I'm making a generalization here, be more progressive in their outlooks about things, is most of the framing of social problems I see coming from advocacy organizations are about care and about fairness and a social justice kind of fairness, right? So as I said before, and as Height has talked about, conservatives really endorse fairness as well, but it's, as he calls it, a karmic fairness. You kind of get what you put, you get out what you put in. But the other problem with care as a value is for social problems is that, well, is compassion the role of government? Or is compassion the role of individuals and nonprofits and charitable institutions? So we do a lot of sympathy for the vulnerable, sympathy care for the poor, and that kind of thing can really easily be rejected because it's not the role of government. And we know a dominant narrative is that government is the problem. So I think this is interesting in that progressives could maybe do a better job at framing things in terms of a more diverse moral palette and really thinking about how their issues might attach to these other things. But I just throw that out there. Let me give you an example of what a values frame even looks like. So I was doing some energy issues in New England, and this is the beginning of a report. Energy issues are important to our economy now and into the future. I said, well, why don't you just do this? Vermont people want to leave their children and grandchildren a world that is as healthy and sound as the one they inherited. That means addressing energy challenges. So it's just a different way to open the conversation, right? So the first one, the before, is you're starting at the issue level. You're not starting at the value level. So people get to map on what they think that's about. And that could be the free market, that could be we don't have a big enough budget to do this, that could be you're a wacky lefty environmental, you know, whatever it is. So you drive the conversation in a different direction when you use that kind of value of stewardship. I thought this was going to be more of a conversation, but I keep talking at you. Does anyone want to interrupt or ask a question or just kind of hold it for the end? Yeah.
I've seen that exact value used to promote completely specific, completely different positions. One which I consider to be scientifically valid, and one in which I consider not to be scientifically valid. So, I mean, what you're presenting is definitely a way to get people to listen to your message and to frame it in a value that they believe in, but. But how does that then set you apart from the other side if you're both using the exact same values to support your positions?
That's troubling. I mean, I think conservatives have been really good at framing things with values, right? So they were doing a lot of this is about the future prosperity thing, and then there was some research which was suggesting we need to be using that value too, and then you're just competing on the same level. So what do you mean in terms of this one? Can you give the specific example? Then I might be able to respond.
Well, on energy, for example, okay? You can look at ads from oil and coal companies that will tell you that the reason why we need to invest in clean coal is because our children will depend upon a vibrant and internal source of energy.
Yeah.
And then, of course, you get the opposite argument from people who are arguing against coal and for solar and wind and renewables.
Right, because they know that's salient. So I'm really glad you asked the question at this time, because I'm focusing on values and causal stories, but those are only two parts of the frame. I mean, the other is messenger, right? The other is the way that you're displaying your data. I mean, this is sort of the core piece of the story that you have to tell. You're not going to get around that, because people who know that values works are going to use them. But it's just a way to introduce the conversation in the way that this is what they were saying. This is what my client was saying. This is a part of the reason we want to do that. So, like, state it up front so that you don't at least immediately, I mean, energy is a politically charged issue, get it sucked into the, free market frame, which is what they were up against. I don't know if that helps. Let's look at, okay, we'll look at some more examples, okay? Because it's really the lack of framing with values that is the problem. People aren't doing this. I don't see a lot of scientists doing this very well. But let's talk about the second piece, the causal story, which is beginning with a clear problem definition, explaining consequences, and articulating solutions. The reason causal stories are really effective is because they help fix some big problems in expert communication. Untranslated expertise, including jargon. Daddy, I don't want a retainer, really? I always demand one. And overly technical language that people don't understand. So failure to translate, here's a jargon problem which you all could probably look at and agree is a jargon problem. This is from a medical study on cancer patients, which I cannot make heads or tails of. I don't know what any of that means. But even in psychology, we have terms, gene expression, confidence interval, p-value, not to mention p-hacking, effect size, you know, CBT, ODD, GAD, the WISC, DSM. These, we might not think of these things, just insert an acronym here, co-occurrence, dual diagnoses, comorbid executive functions. So you have to go out there with the expectation that the public doesn't understand what you understand. They do not fill in the blanks. They jump to conclusions based on their experiences and expectations, and don't expect the media to tell the story you want them to tell. They have schema too. They have dominant ways of thinking about issues based on culture. So I'll give you an example from working with graduated driver licensing efforts at the Center for Highway Research Safety. So this is how these folks had been talking about why graduated driver licensing would be a good policy, because inexperience not only puts young drivers at risk, it also puts their passengers and others on the road at risk. So children are, young people are on the road and harming us. So instead, they tell a more causal story, just like when learning any new skill. The more experience you gain under supervision, the more effective you become. GDL provides young drivers with practical experience under supervision, improving their ability to manage risks and make our roads safer for all drivers. Okay, so you might be sitting there saying, oh, but it's so long. Yeah, it doesn't fit on a 3x5 card. But this, I mean, getting it down and getting the story down, then you can certainly tweak it. I know it sounds like this is an elevator speech for a tall building and you've only got 10 floors, then you've got to get this out. But the key is flipping around that it's not inexperience and the risk, which is queuing up these sort of crisis and negative frames in people's heads, and they think about car crashes because that's what they're thinking about, but instead making about it experience under supervision, that it's like learning any other new skill. It's just a simple thing that if you don't do this, people fill in the blanks themselves. So one other caution I want to give you, and I feel like this is where I need some courage, as Dr. Hart was suggesting, and I'm not sure I have it for this, but I would really encourage you to read Shantoi Iyengar's research on framing and media effects and the effects of personal storytelling. So he talks about two kinds of stories. Let me just get through those. Episodic stories, which are about individual cases or specific events, kind of a telephoto lens on the subject, which could be the victim, the perpetrator, what, you know, fill in the blank. So it's a just the facts kind of frame. And then thematic stories, which are about issues, which use a wide-angle lens, which shows context, which explains patterns and trends. And he has found that when poverty, crime, terrorism are depicted in episodic terms, viewers' causal accounts, as well as their prescriptions of treatment responsibility, were directed to poor people, criminals, and terrorists. So people reason within the frame that you give them. And so even if you're telling, say, a client success story, often the public will attribute to that person's character, okay, even if they came out of a program. So I had a client in Florida, did this great after-school program, very successful. They were about to go interview all these high school kids that came out of this after-school program who had just graduated, and I said, please don't do that. Because people are going to see those stories and say, that kid would have been fine without this program. He's, you know, he would have done just fine. So instead, I had them tell the story from the provider's point of view, who could talk about many different kids who came through this program. That way the program would be up front. So thematic stories aren't, it's not like one is about people and the other one takes all the people out. Episodic stories use an individual case or an individual story as a vehicle, and they can backfire, right? Because that's the frame that you're presenting. Here's an example. Episodic story would be a personal story about a client who struggles with addiction, even if it's a success story. A thematic story would be a story about how addiction happens, maybe the neurobiology of addiction, who knows, and interventions that work and why. So that would just be an example of how to do that kind of change. So why are those kind of strategies a problem? Personal attributions are the default or automatic inference we make for the causes of other people's behavior, right? I tripped, he fell. We know that research. And so those inferences are only corrected when people have sufficient cognitive resources and motivation to do so. So we need to give people sufficient cognitive resources and motivation to not just think this is all about individual people, but there's systems and structures. Martin Gillens, who's a professor of political science at Princeton, says that he thinks the most important explanation of why Americans oppose welfare spending or cash assistance to the poor is that they believe that a large proportion of the people receiving benefits are undeserving, right? I mean, that's a frame now, undeserving poor. And I really believe that's a consequence of how we tend to communicate about these issues. I said in my breakout session that I don't think we don't have enough change on social issues and resolution to social problems because people don't care, or, you know, that they're being insular in their thinking. I think it's a communications issue. We haven't shown them what their responsibility can be because we do so much of the kind of the product marketing based approach to social change communications. So we need different kinds of stories. I really hate these keep calm things, but I saw one and I thought I should have used it here. Different kinds of stories are really needed if your goals are to improve understanding of social problems and build support for policy. And obviously, as designated driver showed us, we have to rethink our measures of communication success, right? It raised awareness, but to what effect? Did it make policy more difficult? So I want to close with a couple examples. We're talking about health equity here. This is an example of the kind of framing that I helped this health equity partnership start doing. Instead of that awful infographic, right? So they started talking in these ways, that we all benefit when all residents of our state have equal opportunity for good health, but we face challenges in promoting and protecting health that requires innovative approaches. So it's trying to get at that American ingenuity value, right? Today in New Hampshire, we're experiencing a growing diversity within our population. At the same time, we face a lack of diversity within the healthcare workforce. There's the problem statement. Research is clear that greater diversity in health professions reduces barriers, opens pathways in a number of ways. For example, when healthcare providers and systems are responsive to their patients' cultural backgrounds, patients are more likely to receive appropriate care. Solution. And then a call to action. You know, we have an opportunity to get ahead of the curve here. This is how we're working. We're part of this collaborative. Join us. You know, that kind of language. And the change to this infographic, it went from this to this. So We decided to make it about creating pathways to health in New Hampshire and use this highly used graphic. We just made it into a sun on social determinants of health, so that the social determinants were really the first thing people saw underneath this idea of creating pathways. There's a pathway going through the mountains there. And it says good health starts in our communities, schools, and homes. I mean, that was even intentional, not to say homes, schools, and communities, but communities, schools, and homes. Health is central to opportunity. To realize our state's true potential, we need to do everything possible to support the health of everyone here. And right now, certain communities in our state don't have equal opportunity for good health. But we can solve this by supporting policies and programs that remove barriers and open pathways to good health across communities. So that's that whole metaphor piece being really helpful in the causal story, right? So as I mentioned, for the infographic, they decided to not do the race-based disparities data, but they wanted to show something. So they used education level, a survey that they had done on reports of being in good health by education and income level, which is itself, of course, disparities data. but in a state like New Hampshire, it wasn't going to be as highly charged. So they wanted to take the racial disparities data out and contextualize it in a different way, not in this. And then working together on innovative solutions. So this is a little bit of a closer up. So it's also much brighter, right? So it has a value, it talks about determinants of health, it has solutions, it says get involved. And then one other example, was doing some work with Good Shepherd Services, which is a multi-service youth serving organization in New York City, and they were doing their annual neighborhood report. And let me just show you what the first draft I got looked like. It was titled "The Deep Impact of Concentrated Poverty." Children growing up in very low-income families have a higher risk of poor academic achievement, negative behavioral outcomes, and physical health problems, all of which can have major impacts on their later life outcomes and on their ability to emerge out of poverty. Who's responsible? The child, the parents, right. If children aren't doing well, you blame the parents. They tried to get a little community-based here. Neighborhoods of concentrated poverty further compound these negative outcomes as they isolate poor families from opportunities for advancement. Children in high-poverty neighborhoods tend to go to schools where nearly all students are poor. As a result, the cycle of poverty persists. But the problem is, what are neighborhoods of concentrated poverty? Are they just where poor people live? Like, you actually haven't shown. You can't just talk about poverty, right? You have to explain what that actually means and how that happens, because most people will just say, oh, well, that's neighborhoods of concentrated poor people, and blame the parents for not working hard enough, not going back, you know, that this is just going to cue up every stereotype. So I said, okay, so we have to work on changing this. What data are you going to show? And this is what they sent me. almost like this. And I said, you're not going to show that. What, could you map it? Oh, we can map it. Like, maybe you shouldn't map it either. But I mean, this is just, you know, poverty, family poverty, extreme poverty, less than so many of the data that we have at our disposal, right, are pretty individualistic indicators. I mean, we could do a whole session on why we collect what we collect and what we don't collect. But at Brandeis University, there's a big project called Diversity Data Kids. I don't know if other people, some people are using this in it. So it allows you to actually have a different conversation. So we reframed the report instead of deep impact of concentrated poverty. It became expanding the geography of opportunity. So here's the value. When all New Yorkers have equal opportunity to achieve the American dream, there are tangible social and economic benefits for us all. The reality, however, is that geography often plays a major role in determining one's opportunity for health, well-being, and future success. in the Brooklyn and Bronx neighborhoods where GSS programs are concentrated, children and families are disconnected from resources and opportunities that are available to those in higher income neighborhoods. So, and then you have to say what they are. Okay, there is a structural problem here. So through a network of strategically located youth and family development and educational support programs, we are addressing structural disparities and expanding the geography of opportunity. So you see how that's a totally different story? Just kind of based on this, I know it's a little wonky, expanding the geography of opportunity, but we're all kind of nerds and we liked it and thought it worked okay. And I, you know, the president had, was bringing the neighborhood report around and really getting different kinds of feedback, you know, and different engagement with it. And they did the map, but not based on, so I forgot to tell you, the one map they had 15 different maps like that for each indicator. So instead, we used this opportunity index from diversitydatakids.org, so that it's an index, and it's access to healthcare, affordable housing, access to healthy food, measures of, I think, youth inclusion and community safety, and probably post-secondary enrollment. And yeah, there's income and poverty in there too. But it's more contextual and indicator. So one map, and then they did breakouts because Red Hook looks like, why are you in Red Hook? But so they did breakout to show those tracks a little bit differently. So it's, I hope these examples are helping you see that you know, you actually have the tools. You have what you need to do what you need to do. It's thinking a little bit differently. And tomorrow, for those of you who are in the track with me, we're really going to dig into this. I'm going to make you come up with your elevator speech. We're going to talk about metaphors and that kind of thing. But for now, I'll just close and thank you for your attention.
Questions? Comments, discussion?
Hi, thank you. That was really exciting and helpful.
Oh, good.
But I just have a question about, like, sort of the power of individual stories, because a lot of times when we do, like, policy advocacy or when we do press conferences to advocate for particular kinds of legislation, we've always, like, brought,
you know,
community members to put a face to the story.
Yep.
And I was just wondering, like, if we should also rethink that strategy of, you know, like, actually putting face to it.
I know I'm an outlier on this. I mean, it's sort of like my life's mission to get public hearings and legislatures not populated by individual stories. And I think there's reason to rethink the strategy. I mean, I've been in a lot of hearings where, Head Start expansion is up, and they bring out the Head Start parents. And also, child advocates are expected to care. So they're not as legitimate messengers as pediatricians and business owners. So I encourage people to really think outside the box, even as much as whose vote do you need, who do they listen to in that community, who can you get in that legislator's community to step in and talk about these things. So a lot of the work that my clients do is train other messengers who aren't themselves, you know, the advocate or the issue expert, to also speak on their issues. So I know we want to put a face on the problem, but I think that is a schema that we have about communications that is assailable by the data on, you know, Shanto and others, Frank Gilliam's research as well. So
thank you.
At least don't make it prominent. At least don't make it prominent. Yeah.
The presentation is very compelling, but it seems like a really tall order from getting from point A to point B from.
Point A being
lack of opportunity, or point A being the poverty dimension, and point B being the lack of opportunity. Is there pedagogical content to help people kind of build and structure messages progressively?
Oh, sure. I mean, there's all kinds of it, which I spend my days bookmarking. So in terms of how to help you develop your own message about
Yeah,
that,
yeah, exactly.
And in particular, I would really look to the Opportunity Agenda's website on this, because they've developed a lot of materials for, I mean, it's going to say it's for advocates who are talking about opportunity and poverty, but they have really great tools on that specific question. But I'm happy to, if you want to take a card, and I'll send it to you or others.
Just a quick observation. The value reframing to me struck me as establishing in-group.
Mm.
That you all value this, we value this, we're all part of the same in-group.
Yeah. Right. I think that's great. Yeah.
I mean, I agree. I think that you're right and you're great too.
yeah, it's a conversation over, but I was talking to someone else about this, that I think Brendan Nyhan, who is at Dartmouth, has done a study on validation as a way of reducing the entrenchment of different opinions on different issues, is saying, I know you're a good person and we're going to have this conversation. And that's kind of what the values frame does, right? Which is maybe, I know I didn't totally answer your question, I'm just not as concerned about, you know, the other side using the same thing too, because I think the frame is bigger than just the values. It's about how you're telling the whole story. But I know it's a concern. You don't want to just jump on the other side's frame and then try to wrangle it to your, you know, to your side. No, sure. Yeah. Yeah, the energy companies absolutely have. Yeah. I blame Al Gore, but anyway. Okay.
Your slide that this woman asked to go back to about Vermont and Vermont people, uh-huh, in terms of concern about children and grandchildren. And I guess I'm going to share my immediate reaction to that and maybe ask you if there's any science to help explain my reaction, which is I immediately think of politicians and they use that verbiage. And I think to myself, they're not really thinking about me or my children, if I had children, or my nieces and nephews as African Americans.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm wondering, you know, how does this value frame actually exclude some individuals in terms of the authenticity and,
yep,
and so forth?
So this is why I think it's really important to look at, for today's conversation, I said, start talking with values, and here are some that seem that the research holds up really works. But I don't think you can just plop in a value to any issue. And the best framing is based on specific research for, so what are the values that invigorate in a positive way what you're talking about? You know, so on immigration, you don't want to use this stewardship for their young race. You don't want to use this. But a notion of interdependence and problems in, you know, similarly with poverty, you know, I've seen really skillful things done with this notion that when any one group is left behind, it brings us all down. And so we have to start thinking in a different way. So, yeah, so you don't want to use any value for anything. There's research that looks at values by issue, which is really powerful. Does that help?
Thank you so much. A very interesting, useful presentation. You mentioned Jonathan Haidt's work.
Yeah.
He has a lot of concerns that we in psychology are very much to the left.
I know.
And some of the way you framed, like, the sort of how particular kinds of narratives might be hijacking the conversation, like government tends to be a problem. These are basic sort of conservative positions, I would argue that. And so I just wondered, I wondered whether that was, is that contributing to some polarization?
I actually don't. I mean, I think some of us who are more left might think of them as conservatives, but it's startling with how easy these things come up across political ideology and across education level, and et cetera. I mean, the individual bootstrap story is not just a conservative story. Yeah. Does that, am I not answer, or you, well, did you ask a question?
I mean, at least my read on that slide.
Yeah.
I have a couple libertarian friends, uh-huh. If they watch that slide, they would basically say, I believe, and not put it, but you're characterizing them as falling into traps when,
I see.
You know, that then they're just being characterized as unthinking individuals who
Whereas
the progressive actually thinks it through and has scientific evidence for their values are more reflective.
No, I think those are American cultural narratives that are really easy for all of us to think. And, you know, I mean, I've seen tax ballot initiatives. I didn't know which side was which because they are all doing the taxes are bad message because they know people don't like taxes. So even the progressives were saying, this isn't going to be really a tax or whatever. Like, you can't tell which is which. So.
Hi, thank you.
Hi, Seth.
How do you avoid oversimplification when trying to drill down a message into essential values and still being able to get the real point across?
It's hard. It's hard work. I mean, you're all scientists and that's hard work, right? So this is like the science of communication translation as applied to something else. And I mean, it also depends on the medium. So, you know, we knew what we wanted to do with that infographic. I could show you one more thing that might help. It depends on the medium. You know, that neighborhood report was going to be this totally dense multi-page report, and like, you know, you could do this actually in a few pages, and it took a lot of editing and a lot of back and forth with us. But I mean, I think that got them what they wanted to do, right? I mean, I know you and I talked, and you have some pretty complex, complex research too. But I'm up for the challenge. So someone mentioned earlier. I'm sorry, I thought I was at the same place. The research at the Center on the Developing Child and that the Frameworks Institute did on all the metaphor development for early childhood issues, right? So I worked with an organization called Portland Defending Childhood in Portland, Maine, and they give clinical treatments to evidence-based clinical treatments for kids exposed to violence. They do violence prevention training in our community. And so they hired me to, you know, do some training, develop some master frames for them. And then I worked with a filmmaker who lives here in DC to do a public service announcement for them. And so I thought I would show you that because this also has all of those components. It has values and the causal stories with the metaphors, and it's animated. So it has a totally different feel from if it was just going to be a talking head. So let's look at that.
As Mainers, we've long relied on our spirit of ingenuity and innovation to strengthen our communities. We know that we're all in this together, and that it's only by working together that we can address our challenges and build the kind of future we want for our children. First, we have to support stronger brains. The brain's architecture is built over time and from the bottom up, just like a house. Sturdy architecture is built when children have stable, positive experiences and relationships with caring adults at home and in the community. But severe or repeated exposure to violence and trauma without the support of caring adults can cause toxic stress responses in children, which can weaken the brain's architecture with damaging effects on health, learning, and behavior across the lifespan. But a supportive, stable relationship with at least one caring adult can buffer toxic stress, preventing or reversing its effects. That is why it's essential for communities to put in place strategies that can prevent and address toxic stress. And that's exactly what Portland Defending Childhood is doing here in our city through education, services, supports, and treatments. To ensure healthier futures for our next generation of parents, teachers, and community leaders, we are working to expand our reach here in Portland. To find out how you could be a supportive adult to children in our community or learn about our trainings and services, visit our website at www.portlanddefendingchildhood.org.
I mean, that I should have said at the beginning, before I showed that, you know, think of the normal PSA you would see on childhood exposure to violence, right? So this was getting tons of play because it was telling the science, it was translating the science, it was something new, it was upbeat, it's, we can do this and we're offering this service. So that, and the visual, you know, the visualization of the metaphor also helps do that, do the translation piece too. So that's kind of the direction of things that I'm talking about. I know it's a lot to think about at the end of the day. Thank you all so much. I really appreciate it.